A lot of my work is based on video. Yeah, I make a lot of video work and photographic work. When I say video work, obviously I use film also, especially 16mm film, super 16mm film. It's moving image. And with almost every video piece that I make, I will have a body of photographic work that goes with it, which is not the same, but that kind of work around the same themes. The work, in terms of the style of the work, it changes and varies according to the subject. A lot of them in the past were shot in Algeria, still are, but not only. The style of filming can be quite poetical, let's say, and very much based on landscape or seascape, but it can also, at times, be more documentary-like. So it depends on the subject, really. Before that, I used to be more with sculpture, perhaps. Or objects that I will make, a lot with wallpapers. But since, I would say, a good 10 to 12 years, it's been mainly film and video, and photography has been my main mediums. It probably happened when I started being interested in this notion of oral history in my work, I think in 2002, where, because of the sound element and the interview element, for me it made sense that I work with video. So I think the first piece I did, probably, I mean, important piece, let's say, I did using video was in 2002 when I shot my mother and my daughter, the piece called Mother Tongue. But photography is always quite present in the work, not as important as the video work, but it is. It's still very much so. Sometimes I do work that relates, photographic work that relates to the video work. Like, for example, Mother Tongue, if we take that example, I did a photographic piece of work which is along the same subject, but which is obviously a free piece, a triptych, photographic triptych, using my mother, my daughter, also myself. I became interested, or let's say I became bored of the medium of photography and video as a flat medium, i.e. something that you see as in a projected room, or photograph printing on you know, photographic paper and framed, put on the wall. So I kind of started being interested in working more with the space and the sculpture. So I started playing along with this idea of using more screens, you know, in an installation for video. And in terms of photography, a lot of light boxes. But not only the light box or the screens and having a multitude of them, but also playing with the cables, showing them, hanging them in the space, hanging the light boxes or the screen in the space, with speakers dropping in there also. So yeah, much more sculptural video. And you can see that in Floating Coffin, for example. But also with the photography, I kind of really like light boxes because they're boxes, because they're three-dimensional photography for me. And with the light, obviously, and the cables, you know, I play along that, because a lot of my work is around the sea. The cable or the rope is a very interesting element for me. So I tend to, instead of hiding it, as a lot of what we do usually with photography and video, we tend to hide all the cables, actually use them in the work, in the practice. First of all, I like the audience to interact in a different way than if they're sitting on a bench, for example. For me, sculpture, it's about having many angles and perhaps even touching those angles. And with video, when it's hanging in the space in that sculptural manner, I like the audience to decide and to choose and to be attracted by certain angle or certain area in the space itself. So in some ways, for me, it's like they're almost touching all those kind of different aspects of the work. So there is there a sculptural element. But in terms of editing, because I'm quite a messy filmmaker, I don't script, never actually. I have an idea usually of what I want to film, but it's when I go and shoot that really the idea develops. And then when I come back in the editing, that's really where my scripting mind happens. For me, I started working with a crew in 2006 when I had my first commission with Film and Video Umbrella. And that was very important for me because not only my work was going to be better shot than it used to when I used to film it myself, but also I was going to work with a crew. the earlier work, it was always me and the family, or me and the camera, and this time it was me and a group of people. And for me, my crew, the people I work with are very important. They've become friends over the years. I work always with the same person, apart from some sound recordists that might change according to the project and the timetable. For me, I see them more than just technician. I see them really as collaborator, because we bounce back a lot of ideas, and they know me so well now that sometimes they can go off almost by themselves and shoot some things, you know, if I'm busy doing something else during the shooting period. When I shoot, I never watch what I've been shooting. If I spend, like just now, I've spent 5 days in Marseille, we shot 5 days. I perhaps once or twice in the evening had a quick look. I tend to not. What I tend to do a lot is I shoot a lot. That's only when I do HD, obviously. When I do film, there is a restriction in terms of the cost, so I can't shoot as much. But I tend to always shoot more. Obviously, it's always, when I say more, it's not just anything. It's things that are related to the project. But I tend to want more than I need, really. And that allows me to actually resource more things, you know. When I do work, I don't really think of the relationship of the work with other artists, although I'm sometimes aware that other artists might have worked on the similar subject. So if I do know that, I will perhaps do a bit of research or go and see a show or some work. In terms of the society, well, I think my work is always a bit connected to some kind of political, you know, agenda or whatever. Basically, I get an idea, I get obsessed by that idea. So I get obsessed, the image keeps coming back, so I have to go back and shoot it. Obviously, while I get obsessed, I know I'm obsessed by it for a reason. There must be a reason that I was attracted by this image or that place or that sound or that story. So I start doing a bit of research around it. Why? What is it about? And then I find an angle, just a little thing that triggers my interest, and I think, yes, it works, and it connects with my previous work, so let's go for it. Obviously, the idea is there, but it's always, I won't say basic, but it's always not vague either. It's there, but I don't have all the elements yet around it. But that's okay for me, because the elements happens, it starts happening during the shooting period and after during the editing. In my work of transmission of memory or oral history, although I'm interested in this idea of passing on, of telling the story and listening, because the part of listening for me is extremely important. I'm a brilliant listener, and I've kind of developed this kind of skill over the years with doing the work I've done. It's also that what you hear or what you say might not be always authentic, true. It might be true for me, but it might not be true to you. It might be true for us, but not to somebody else. What we choose, I mean, the process, the editing process in what we say also is very interesting for me. So relating to the editing process of me when I did the video, sometimes when I edit the piece, I wonder, you know, what I'm saying, the way it's edited. Am I really portraying exactly what the person has wanted to say?
Je m'appelle plus je vais, plus je m'appelle toujours ce que mon père m'avait dit. Il m'a dit, tu sais. Comment qu'il m'avait dit ? Il m'a dit, tu ne peux pas connaître, je ne te souhaite jamais de connaître la solitude d'un vieux.
So the fragility is extremely important, the gaps also, the kind of the black gaps or the gaps or the in-between, all those spaces. And also, a big question all the time for me is like, I come back with 8 hours of sometimes interviews and I only use 45 minutes. What happens to what's remaining? You know, I've decided to only include those 45. So sometimes I'm thinking of making a piece of work about all the unwanted or the rejected part of the interview, which could be quite interesting because we'll find it also fascinating. For me, the work really of an artist that will really touch me, it has to touch me emotionally. I'm not, I love conceptual work. I don't have a problem with that, obviously, but it has to have more than just the content, the concept. For me, the form has to be as important than the content. But that's personal to me. So if the work can have both, strong ideas, conceptually very strong, but also visually very touching, that's brilliant for me. I think somebody who might sometimes do that to me, for me also, it's somebody like Monahatum. Some work I find extremely violent, yet very poetical, and in that sense, they kind of talk to me here, you know. My family for a long time inspired me, and I think they still do. I love, and I get very inspired by elderlies. I love working with older people. All that because, I guess, of this notion of memory and experience and knowledge and beauty, landscape, you know, seascapes, you know, it depends. I can't say, you know, there is I'm very attracted also by, and that's in my life in general, just not in terms of practice, but old things. You know, I'm somebody who's into vintage and who like my 50s or 40s stuff. So when I see an archive with old photographs, you know, I'm excited. You know, like I'm excited when I see an old 50s lamp or 40s lamp. So you know, it's there is something with me and the past for sure. There is something with me and an attraction to the past somehow, history, objects, you know, photography. I don't see them as ambiguous, I don't know. I see them quite straightforward, you know. Perhaps a piece like Floating Coffin might be seen as more complex because it's got so many screens and it really demands more to the audience. But at the same time, it's quite straightforward. It's landscape, it's strong sound, it's the content is quite straightforward also. So I don't know, I can't answer this question really. I want the different readings, I want different reaction to the work. I don't want everybody to have the same reaction. And actually often, if I can discuss with somebody what they thought about it, it's quite nice, even if it's to hear criticism and bad ones, you know, it's okay for me. The work made about Algeria history, for example, like the Algerian War or the Algerian immigration to France or whatever, will have a different response in Algeria because people know quite well the facts, the names, the dates, the stories, the experiences. So it will be, the response will be very different. And the response might be even negative, might be like, oh, we've done that before, we heard, or we've seen, or we've read it. As if I show it in France, the response will be different. Hence why at one point I get censored in France with some type of work. The same work is shown here in London, no censorship, you know. So yeah, I mean, it is definitively depending on the context and depending on the work, the reading is different. But I find that quite interesting. But other pieces like Middle Sea, Sapphire, which I will call work which are a bit more universal, a bit broader, because the signifier is not so much about Algeria or Algerian history. The reading is more or less kind of, yeah, not similar, but it hasn't got that kind of... because the signifier are not just set in Algeria or France, the reading is much more open. It is a necessity. I think art is a necessity. Art full stop is a necessity for anyone, really. First of all, for the maker, you know, for me it's a necessity to make it, but also for people to see it, and hopefully they'll get something from it. I don't know, you know, I hope so. If I wasn't an artist, I could be three things. A sailor, which I know is not really realistic. Secondly, a lighthouse keeper, which is something that I would have liked to have done, although I know women really never did those jobs. But the third one, which is totally more realistic, it's to run a shop with vintage clothes.